I've been a resident of Eagle River for 34 years. I came to Alaska originally working for ARCO Alaska, originally as an exploration geophysicist, and I spent some time working as an operator with the Lisburn startup team, and then after that I was part of the Prudhoe Facility Planning Department. After that I spent the next 20 years working in the Anchorage School District as a teacher, an instructional coach, and eventually as an IT supervisor. I retired 2 years ago. My kids are grown up and they've moved on, so I'm in a position now where I can actually give something back to the community, so that's why I'm in this race. I also got tired of the partisan politics as I sat and watched what's going on down in Juneau. We're actually a very resource-rich state with $60 billion in the bank. What we need is just people to set aside their partisan idealism and sit down and actually work on solutions that are good for the whole state. Yes, I think the permanent fund earning reserve has to be a part of any conversation in terms of a comprehensive long-range fiscal plan. And that was part of the original intent of setting that account up. We're finally to that point where we've always had the ability to draw on that earnings, and we're to the point now where we have to. So, yes. Yes, I do. In fact, we are the only state in the nation that doesn't have any sort of a broad-based tax. That would be a broad-based income or sales tax. I think it's time that Alaskans start participating in that. Governor Hammond actually said one of his biggest regrets was rescinding that tax that was in place back in the 1980s. Whether it be sales tax or income tax, I think a sales tax is probably much more regressive, and that it's going to hit the low-income families disproportionately harder, and it's going to hit those small communities that already have a local tax in place much harder. So I'd be more in favor of an income tax to make sure that all of us are paying our fair share for the goods and services that we receive. We also have about 25% of the workforce in this state that doesn't live in this state, and that's 30% of the income in terms of payroll. So let's start capturing some of that revenue from those out-of-state workers who are still relying on our goods and services. All right, first I think we need to recognize that, yes, in fact, we do have a crime problem, but the crime problem that we have, it was not caused by SB 91. And we're hearing a lot of calls for repeal of SB 91. That bill was, in fact, a piece of legislation in response to a rising crime rate, which has been trending upwards since 2011, combined with a recidivism rate of 65%. Now, over the past 5 years, we've seen the legislature cut programs for protection and prosecution and prevention. And at the same time, they failed to fund programs for rehabilitation and treatment. So it's no wonder that we have a crime problem. SB 91 wasn't perfect, and the last session actually took some steps to address some of those issues. We need to continue to examine that and tweak it as necessary. But I think the biggest issue is that we need to start funding the rehabilitation and treatment programs that were part of it and not included in there. We can't just solve the crime problem by treating it in isolation. The crime that we're seeing is really a manifestation of other underlying social ills, and we're going to have a comprehensive package of programs that are going to deal with domestic violence, substance abuse, homelessness, joblessness, education, all of that combined. And all of that's going to be very expensive, there's no question about it, but we're going to pay for it one way or the other. You can pay for it on the front end by investing in those programs, or you can pay for it on the back end in terms of incarceration. I would much rather be proactive and invest on the front end rather than reactive on the back end. Yeah, again, we've got to fully fund those treatment programs. We simply don't have enough money or enough prison space in this state to lock up every substance abuser or drug addict in the state. So we need to get to the underlying problem of that and start treating them rather than incarcerating them. The biggest concern I'm hearing is number one, crime. They're fearful. But again, I think they haven't really gotten all the information on what's driving that underlying crime rate. The second concern has to do with the dividend check being capped. Probably those are the two biggies. Absolutely, human activity is changing the climate, not only in this state, but across the world. As lawmakers or as a state of Alaska, you know, we're sort of on the leading edge of this climate change because it's changing faster in the Arctic than it is other places. So the lawmakers have a responsibility to, one, acknowledge that fact, recognize where the risks are, see if we can mitigate and be proactive in sort of remediating some of those risks, but also look for opportunities. As this climate change, it's going to open up new opportunities in terms of transportation, agriculture, tourism. So we need to be ready to not only mitigate the risk, but also capitalize on the opportunities.